Is up, everybody. I know I have been gone, but this week we are going to be talking about Diomedes, the hero of the Trojan War, or at least one of them, the son of Tydeus, and overall awesome warrior, and quite possibly strongest man on the planet. Now, the first thing that we have to understand about Diomedes was that he was the son of Tydeus, who was the king of Argos, and was chosen by the goddess Athena. Now, Athena was the goddess of war and the goddess of wisdom. So not only was he from a royal lineage, but he was also the chosen of one of the major gods. Now, we got to have some backstory on Diomedes, and it starts with his dad. His dad, Tydeus, was a part of a group called the Seven Against Thebes. Now, these men led armies against the heavily fortified city of Thebes, and they were awesome. These guys were some of the ultimate warriors. They were former Argonauts. They were fighters, man. And they went to this city and they lost. Pretty much all of their soldiers died. They came home, their heads hung in shame. And a couple years later, after having to deal with the loss that his father went through during this battle, Diomedes, along with the sons of the other members of the Seven Against Thebes, formed their own group called the Epigoni. They went back to Thebes and they destroyed the city in one day. One day. These kids. So it was just a major upset. And they came home, heads held high. Later down the line, Diomedes' dad died. Tydeus at this point is dead. Diomedes has taken over the throne, and he was approached by Agamemnon, another king from another part of Greece, whose wife had been kidnapped. And he said, "Diomedes, I am leading a force of fighting men against Troy to save my wife. Will you join me?" And Diomedes was like, "Yes, yes, I will. I will come with you. I am there for all the glory." He brought 80 ships. Now, I know that doesn't sound like a massive amount, but think about it this way. This was back when ships were rare. They were hard to produce. He brought 80 of them filled with warriors. It was the second largest force right behind Agamemnon. The Trojan War went on for years. Years. A massive amount of time. And this was a time when heroes could be forged and heroes' legacies could be made. And Diomedes, even though in the Iliad he has only one or two chapters dedicated to him, he has a legacy like no other. When we look at Diomedes, you have to understand something first and foremost. He's angry, and he is strong. And he is so powerful that he was described by Homer as the master of the war cry. Just intimidating people on the battlefield. The moment they knew who he was, they ran most of the time, unless they were one of the generals or a hero of their side. And his awesomeness does not stop there. He also had some powerful weaponry that was created by Hephaestus himself, the god of the forge. And his weaponry included a suit of armor that could repel almost anything, including arrows. In fact, there's one point during the war when Diomedes is fighting like a madman in the middle of everybody, and one soldier sees an opportunity, pulls back an arrow, and fires it right into Diomedes' heart. And the man doesn't fall. In fact, the arrow breaks on his armor. And when Hector, the general and leader of the Trojan forces, asks this soldier later what happened, that soldier says, "He should be dead. I don't know what happened. I shot him through the heart and it just broke. It was a kill shot. And I don't know why he's still standing." But it gets better, because not only is Diomedes running around in pretty much bulletproof armor during this time, he also is running around with a shield and helmet that is enchanted by Athena herself to shoot fireballs at his command. Now, I know that for myself, if I was a guy running around in bulletproof armor during the Trojan War, early Grecian years, with a shield that could shoot fire, I would be using the fire all day, every day, much less shooting it from my helm. Diomedes never uses it. Diomedes said, I am too much of a man and a fighter for this. I don't need fireballs. I've got a spear that is bigger than a man. Yes, Diomedes ran around with a spear large enough to be considered a human being. Now, the awesomeness does not stop there. When we talk about Diomedes' combat ability and strength, he's actually equated to the Greek hero Achilles. And Achilles was the man. The moment Achilles hits the battlefield, you know what's done. So the Greeks had two awesome super soldiers. The Captain America and Tony Stark out on the battlefield fighting on the same side. The only difference is that Diomedes continued to fight, and Achilles, because his glory was taken from him earlier in the book, literally sat in his tent for a good chunk of time playing the lute, you know, just playing music, you know, and writing some really bad lyrics to, you know, and poetry in his tent until the end of the book, while Diomedes was essentially tearing it up and fighting gods. Oh, that's right. He fights gods. We'll get to that in a moment, though. Here's the thing. On the battlefield, Diomedes meets the Trojan prince Aeneas. Now, Aeneas will later have his own book about how he founds Rome, but he is described as a lord of men and godlike on the battlefield. And Diomedes' first response when he sees this man is, I'm gonna fight him. And fight him he does. He beats Aeneas so badly that the goddess Aphrodite swoops down from Mount Olympus to try and save him. Diomedes at this point has been guided by Athena, and she has enchanted his eyes to be able to see who on the battlefield is a god and who on the battlefield is not. Because remember, Greek gods can change their form and their shape, and they can confuse people. Diomedes knows this is Aphrodite. And his first response when he sees that Aphrodite is trying to save Aeneas is to try and kill her. He does not care that he is literally trying to harm a goddess. And so he throws his spear. It goes through Athena's arm. He's so strong he can actually hurt gods and goddesses. She gets scared and she goes back to Olympus. And instead of Diomedes saying, oh, I may have just messed up there, he starts hurling taunts and starts making fun of Aphrodite as she goes back to Mount Olympus. So, next up, Diomedes is like, well, I'm going to finish what I started with Aeneas over here. Starts moving over to Aeneas, and Apollo comes down to try and save him. But he just saw what happened to Aphrodite. And he starts a fight with Diomedes, and Diomedes starts beating him. So he runs, and the only reason he is able to get away is because every time Diomedes is about to catch up with this god, a popular god of light and archery, he blinds him. He blinds him as he tries to get away. And it's just one of those astounding moments that when we look at it, we have to understand this is a man, a mortal man, who not only has done combat with one god and made her run, but two gods, and this other god is like, no, I'm not even going to do this with you today. I'm out. So Diomedes, after losing his prey in Aeneas, continues to fight on the battlefield. And who does he see with his magical sight but the god of war himself, Ares? Yes, we are now probably talking about a man who could be the original Kratos. Because he sees Ares. And instead of avoiding Ares, Diomedes decides to bull rush Ares' chariot on his own throw his spear. And at this point, Athena's like, well, I'm going to help you. She guides his aim to essentially throw the spear so powerfully that I'm pretty sure it rips a small tear in reality and just makes the universe explode and then come back together again like nothing happened in an instant. It decimates Ares's chariot, forces him off the battlefield. Okay? Diomedes then, after he has forced three gods off of a battlefield, finds Hector, the leader of the Trojan forces, throws his spear that he just picked up after demolishing a chariot at Hector, and the only thing that saves Hector is the combined weight of divine intervention that deflects the spear. That's about where we see the end in the Iliad of Diomedes, but that's not all he does. He then goes on to help Odysseus form the idea of the Trojan horse, leads the Trojan horse initiative from the inside, and then ends the war with the Trojans in one night by confusing them and tricking them to let him in with a gifted horse. That's where we get the term Trojan horse. After that, he's done with the war. He goes home. His wife, however, at home, says, yeah, you're no longer welcome here. You've been gone for 12 years, and boy, bye. Now, a lot of people would probably consider this revenge from the goddess Athena, you know, the goddess of love, the person who can make people fall in and out of love. And I would tend to agree that Athena probably had a hand in this. But Diomedes was like, okay, I'm gone then. Fine, whatever. Didn't need my kingdom anyway. So instead of trying to win back his kingdom, he left. Went on more adventures. And there's a lot of theories as to what happened to him. But, you know, he essentially just does some awesome stuff as he travels through Italy and Egypt and the rest of the world. Just being Diomedes. Being one of the best warriors ever. Like I said, you don't get much better than having a guy who literally can defeat gods and make them run while wearing a shield that shoots flames. So, that's this week. That's Diomedes, one of the coolest warriors of all time. It's good to be back, and if you guys have any requests who you'd like to see next, let me know down below, and y'all have a good one. Bye.